This program is part of American Graduate. Let's make it happen. A public media initiative made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Welcome to Ideas in Action, a television series about ideas and their consequences. I'm Jim Glassman. This week, we begin a two-part examination of the high school dropout crisis in America. It's part of the Corporation for Public Broadcasting's programming initiative, American Graduate, Let's Make It Happen, designed to help local communities address the nation's dropout crisis. Every year, 1.2 million American high school students do not graduate on schedule, and more than one in four fails to earn a diploma. In today's global economy, it is imperative that America improves the rate of high school graduation so that students emerge career and college ready. We'll take a look at two elements key to successful educational turnaround: targeted middle school intervention and effective school leadership. We'll talk to experts and visit schools that are taking concrete steps to increase high school graduation rates. The topic this week: middle school intervention that works. This is Ideas in Action. They're called dropout factories, American high schools where fewer than 60% of students make it to graduation day. Today, about one out of every 10 high schools fits this description. They're clustered in large cities and poor rural areas alike. And for the more than 2 million students attending these dropout factories, the outlook is grim.
Currently, the nation has a graduation rate of right about 75%. Which means that there's about 1 million kids a year that are not getting their diplomas on time. There's 4 million kids in the class of 2010, 3 million got diplomas in June. If you're in your 20s, don't have a high school degree, don't have a work history, are you ever gonna work? Probably not. But every year we're putting 1 million kids towards that future.
For minority students, the problem is even more acute. With a national graduation rate of only 50% for African American and Hispanic students.
Really, the intersection is between poverty and dropping out. But because poverty rates are higher among minorities, we then get higher minority dropout rates.
Just because a kid is poor or their parents are poor doesn't mean that they don't have a lot of ability, that they don't have a lot of potential, because they do. Poverty, economic inequality, other kinds of inequalities mitigate against those kids having opportunities. It's not the ability that they lack, it's the opportunity.
How we doing, guys?
Research shows that making sure students get those opportunities during middle school is critical to increasing graduation rates. By high school, it is difficult to turn most failing or struggling students around.
The best news is that I think this country has finally woken up to the dropout crisis. And so a lot of attention given to early warning indicators, particularly in middle school. Immediately capturing when a student is beginning to, one, miss a lot more class, number two, fail a class, or number three, have disciplinary problems.
Mathematical equation there. What's the equation that I want to see first, all right?
We start by looking at one middle school in Dallas, Texas, that is boosting academic achievement by using student engagement both inside and outside the classroom. This is the Thomas C. Marsh Middle School award-winning ROTC drill team. It is one of the school's hallmark programs, designed to instill discipline and high expectations in students from the surrounding disadvantaged and largely minority community.
We give all students that enter into this building a chance, regardless of their background, their income level, or their ethnicity. They have the opportunity to be the very best, and we ensure our teachers with the skills and materials to do so. One of the reasons why we're one of the best schools in Dallas is due to our test scores from last year. In writing, we were 92% passing. Reading, we were 90%. Math, 90%. Science, 81%.
But such academic success didn't happen overnight.
In 1999, it wasn't the best place to work. A lot of gang activity. Lots of bullying, fighting, you know. Our scores were low. We were, I guess, you know, everything you would think of a big, large urban school district, public school kids. I guess that's what, you know, if you wanted to sum it up.
Corporal David Bates was hired in 1999 specifically to establish an ROTC program as part of an overall plan to boost student performance. Getting students engaged in school is a big part of that effort.
We started with nothing, and then we started fundraising. We started getting uniforms. We started getting, you know, materials. I started writing my own curriculum. 4 or 5 years later, we had all kinds of gear, and we started winning competitions. That's when we got a little bit of people, what's going on over there? A typical school day, okay, always starts off with, you know, we call to attention, and we tell them to take their seats. They all sit down the same way. Procedures are huge, the way we pass out folders, you know, the way I go over the calendar every single day, the way we take notes, the way we sit, the way we stand, the way we walk. Once I get that regimen in, it becomes real easy. I teach first aid, land navigation, time management, organizational skills, history. I do what's called effective army writing, and basically it's just good writing skills. I call it that, and the kids think it's, you know, something different, but really it's good, just good writing.
Kids who are involved tend to have better grades and go on to graduate from college. So we do encourage for them to do something besides just coming to school.
March!
I joined ROTC because I wanted to have the right to say that I was part of some of the trophies that are up there.
Not the way I'd like it to be. Some of you are getting dressed here instead of at home. But we don't get into trouble. We don't bully. We don't wake up and come without doing our hair. If you want to be different, you have to be different from start to finish every day.
When the kids perform for me, they perform at a high level, and they don't want to let me down. So when I just put little things on the table like, we do better, your scores need to be better, you better do this, you better do that, they don't want to let me down. It's been okay not to pay their bills. It's been okay, you know, not to get a referral. It's been okay. You know, at home, that's what it's been. It's just been okay. Well, with that average okay stuff, it's not good enough here.
Coach Bates sets high expectations, expectations that mirror those of the school at large.
We expect for students to have A's and B's on report cards. We expect for them to go to tutoring if they need help. We expect for them to read. We expect for them to do science for our projects. We expect for them to be dressed appropriately for school and to have great behavior. So anything that we want them to do, we expect for them to do it at their very best.
The reason I joined ROTC is because I like what the program does. It changes people's life. What changed my life was from being out there initially, like just being bad, stuff like that. And once I came in here, I learned discipline, how to treat people, how to respect my elders, parents, that why they're here for us, why they do so much for us, and well, we are gonna do something for them when we grow up.
For some students, meeting the expectations of the ROTC program can be quite a transition.
It's really up to them to see if they wanna change, because if you wanna be in ROTC, you have to change. Like, you can't just be slacking off. You can't get in trouble in school. That'll leave a bad reputation on your school.
When I put my uniform on, it's an amazing feeling. I am proud of myself, and it makes you feel like you're actually doing something for your community, and I think that's really important. It's like the most exciting thing. You're out there, and everyone sees you, and they don't just see you as this person. They see you as a cadet at Marsh Middle School.
The discipline is not what a lot of people think discipline is, like, you know, the push-ups and this, that, and the other. It's the self-discipline, the discipline to do what is right when no one is looking. You know, that integrity starts to come into play with some of these kids. Like, they know that they got to do well, or, you know, they'll hear it.
That spirit of community and a spirit of giving and leadership has kind of trickled down from the ROTC down into our core classes and into an overall campus environment. Look at the title, like Black Smoke, the Black Death.
All the teachers at Marsh Middle use job assignments to teach students responsibility and to get them invested in their own education.
One way to make them engaged and feeling important is to give them a job or a task to do. And so if we are doing a collaborative activity in a group, you might make one the actual spokesperson. You might make another one the person that is collecting the supplies afterward and sort of cleaning up the area. And you might make one the actual writer, the person that's actually writing the data down.
The kids all have jobs. When you give a kid a job, he takes it seriously. But here, just passing out folders, not really a great job, but it's their job. They take it seriously.
In the ROTC program, jobs range from menial to management.
My position here in JROTC, I am commander officer. I lead morning. I lead every single day through all these students that come in here. They look up to me and they would like to be up there one day.
Especially being a CEO, I learned that I could be a leader no matter what it is, no matter what occasion it is. I learned how to be committed to something. And if you stay committed to something, you know, you can achieve anything you want.
When students are engaged and well-behaved, it is easier for teachers to do their jobs.
If you're able to teach, then you're able to get results. If you're able to relate to the kids, and there's less distractions with other outside of the classroom items, then you're able to get the results that you need.
It's been 13 years since Coach Bates started the ROTC program at Marsh Middle. He's gone from 78 to 317 students. About a third of the student body now participates in the program. And while his drill team has won numerous national championships, he is most proud of his students' high school graduation rate of 97%. But he's not done yet.
Whatever you scored last time, better be better this time, okay?
You know, everybody's high school graduation. Well, I'm at the point now where I want to take another step. The high school diploma, it's not as good as it used to be. My hopes and goals and dreams for the kids, 100% graduation from college.
We do talk about college a lot at our campus. Our campus has become a branded campus for college. If you walk around the classrooms and the school, you will see college bulletin boards, college projects. The students can wear college t-shirts. We have a college week, and we take them on college field trips. We understand you're going to go to high school. So we just decided to take it a step further to make sure that you're going to be a college graduate.
That's our way of showing them this is our culture. This is what we do at this school. We talk about going to college. So everything that we do, it's about going to college. When they know the end goal, they understand it. They know the reasoning behind why we do things the way we do them.
ROTC helped me prepare to go to high school because as when I came into this program, I don't really know, you know, a lot of leadership skills. So when I walked in, right away I knew I was going to be a leader.
It helped me to be disciplined and organized, and it just helped so much with my grades. I had A's all year, never C's. It was just because of the ROTC program.
The kids love Coach Bates. They respect him. They do not think he's too firm. They understand that he has a goal for them. So they want to live up to that goal, and they do not want to disappoint him. They truly love Coach Bates.
I like to think my students are the best in the world. And that's, I know 100% of the time they are the best in the world when they're with me. Sometimes when they're not with me, they're not the best in the world. But that's what we work on every day.
The kids are special here at Marsh Middle School because they understand that in spite of some of their circumstances, that they will achieve. They understand no matter what, I can make it. I will go to college.
Next, we'll visit a middle school in Indianapolis, Indiana, that is using individual learning data to identify students who are struggling in class. Those students then get the help they need to eventually graduate high school and prepare for a successful future.
A number of ingredients is needed to ensure strong middle school academic success. The staff at Harshman Magnet Middle School in Indianapolis, Indiana, has found a winning combination to help every student succeed, regardless of his or her background.
We have approximately 410 students in the school, of which 87% are free and reduced lunch.
How are you doing, guys? Did you have a good class?
We have approximately 60% African American, 30% Hispanic, 10% white.
Good job.
This school is a story of remarkable turnaround. The principal and the faculty and the staff that the principal has gathered here has really, really embodied the whole sense of leading change, of establishing a sense of urgency, establishing a vision.
How are you?
Before Principal Guffin arrived in 2009, many staff members assumed that the majority poor student body couldn't or wouldn't learn. The students believed it too.
Students were out in the hallways on a regular basis, not attentive in class, heads were down. Some students wanted to go to sleep. There were fights in the building on a regular basis. We decided that that had to change.
Where are you guys supposed to be?
Those changes resulted in significant academic improvement for Harshman students. In Principal Guffin's first year, language and math scores on the Indiana State test improved by 9%. In the second year, they improved by an additional 28%. It was the greatest improvement in test scores by any middle school in the entire state. So how did the students and staff make such great strides in just 2 years? One key factor was collecting data on each and every student to determine where help was needed. Whitney Newton is in charge of gathering, analyzing, and disseminating the data.
The way that we look at students is each student is a holistic person, and we want information about them that will help us meet their needs across the board. Everything from what they need in math to what they need at home and everything in between. So when we're collecting and analyzing data, we want lots of different pieces about each student.
We are constantly looking at how our students are performing today and how can we take that information as a teacher and use that to inform my instruction. What did they do? What did they know? Did they meet the objective that we planned for our classroom?
So it's really looking at the goal for the end of the year, which is broken down into the goal at the end of each unit, which is broken down into the goal at the end of each day. All right, what are we going to do to get there?
The goal at the end of the school year is to pass an exam that measures a student's progress on basic academic subjects. It's called the Indiana Statewide Testing for Educational Progress Plus, otherwise known as ISTEP.
We'll take that ISTEP exam, look at where our deficiencies in our students were, and we will use that to plan an overall plan for each 9 weeks or each semester or the entire year.
The numbers, it was what, a 67% decrease?
We look at where students are strong, where students are weak, and how can we shore those areas up.
In addition to unit exams and report cards every 9 weeks, the staff at Harshman uses 6-question mini tests called scrimmages to benchmark student progress.
So we're looking at every 3 weeks, did they get the standards that were in the pacing guide from the previous 3 weeks, and how are they doing with that? As the coaches, we roll that data out to the teachers and give them a chance each month to look at that data as a team, analyze it, put it together, separate it into different formats, whether it's by standard or by subgroup.
Teachers collect data on a daily basis using what has come to be known as an exit ticket.
You do have an exit ticket on your agenda. You need to fill that out before you leave.
An exit ticket is basically like going over like basically what we learned in that class at that time. And we do it at the end of the class, like before the bell rings.
Number two, what did the scientists discover about that protein?
It doesn't always have to be an official thing, but I always end the class with a wrap-up activity. And it can be just asking questions, going into individual groups and asking individual kids, and asking them in a way that they've got to think about what we've learned on a higher level.
Collecting all of this data is one thing, but organizing it in a useful way is quite another.
Because we have so much data that we're collecting and we're really trying to organize it for teachers, a lot of them are using data, but it's not very effective for them from their perspective because they have it in a packet here and a file here, and it's on this computer program and here on this website. And so what we tried to do was bring it all together onto one database. Very simple, just a two-column spreadsheet online that all the teachers can access at any time.
For example, if the teachers find that 40% of the students are struggling with a topic, they will continue to emphasize it.
Part of my learning as a teacher is to use assessment as a tool to drive my instruction, so I may set a unit to last 2 weeks, but if they're not getting it, I've got to continue to incorporate those while staying on pace with the curriculum.
If only one or two are having difficulty, those students can get personalized help from one of the instructional specialists.
We pull out these students during their elective period and work with them one-on-one or a small group setting to master these standards in a really individualized instructional kind of experience that they can't get within a normal classroom.
Four, what's attached to the X?
60.
So you should divide by?
60.
There you go, okay.
The educational specialists also use a strategy called front loading in many of their one-on-one teaching sessions.
When we cross multiply, basically what we're doing is we're turning our proportion into an equation.
We kind of pre-teach them what they're going to be learning that day, so they're exposed to the vocabulary, they're exposed to the skill a little bit.
You got this one on your own. I'm going to just sort of watch and tell you if you mess up, okay?
It allows them to be the person in the classroom who has their hand up first. It allows them to be the person in the classroom who people look to for the answers. The confidence that they gain and the pride that develops becomes something that is immeasurable and allows students to grow and begin to know, I can do this.
After I worked with Mr. Spencer, it was good because I could understand how the problem worked out, and it was cool.
Principal Guffin and his staff feel that sharing the data with the students themselves is a key to academic success.
The teachers in their classes, so math and language arts, all took their ISTEP scores, handed them out to students, and had them fill out a reflection individually so that they could look at, what was my score? What do I want my goal to be? Why was that my score? Why do I want this to be my goal? And just really allowed each student to see, where am I in comparison to where I'm supposed to be this year?
See right now, you're gonna scare with that right.
The teachers here are strict, but also want you to have fun, be safe, do what you gotta do to get the job done.
It's really exciting to hear kids say, I didn't pass ISTEP last year, but I'm going to pass it this year. It's really powerful to hear a student take that ownership and advocate for themselves and say, I want to pass ISTEP this year, so I am coming to your tutoring this week. We're teaching to our students where they are, where they're coming in, and where we want them to be successful and move on to high school and college and jobs that allow them to be happy.
I've never known a student that has come to school and said, the first day of school, this year, I'm gonna get in trouble.
Are we
Every student that comes to school wants to succeed, and every year they start out with, I'm going to be my best that I can be. And how we respond to them makes a huge difference in how they behave in school.
If you get good grades, that means you'll get far in life and you'll have a house, maybe a good wife. You get good grades, you'll be anything you want to be.
Marsh Middle in Dallas and Harshman Middle in Indianapolis are just two schools making the kind of positive change that is happening all over the country. But there's still more to be done. Join us next time when we take a look at another strategy to curb America's high school dropout crisis, transformative school leadership that works. That's it for this week's Ideas in Action. I'm Jim Glassman. Thanks for watching.
This program is a production of Grace Creek Media and the George W. Bush Institute, which are solely responsible for its content.
This program is part of American Graduate. Let's make it happen. A public media initiative made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.